does the other. If you are not a religious person, efficiency should not be a word that passes your lips. Whereas if you are deeply religious, efficiency is just another way of spelling God, especially in economics. Yeah?
So, but cost-benefit analysis is like a principle that you would apply to your everyday decisions as an individual. So, like, you want to decide should I do X, and you can say this is the pros, these are the cons. So, and it seems like that would be a better way, kind of way. And of course, it's not going to be, you know, you cannot be sure. It's going to be like an educated guess. But it seems like even an educated guess would be preferable to just drawing a lot and, you know, saying yes or no. Right?
Well, I ask you, the important things in life, am I going to marry him or her? Let's see, the costs of marrying him. You must be kidding. Marriage is a long-term arrangement. You haven't the faintest idea what the costs are going to be. And you haven't the faintest idea what the benefits are going to be. You can do that exercise, especially if you come from a culture that says you shouldn't do it before you go through an That's like having three prayers before you have a meal. You shouldn't eat that bread until you have thanked this one, this one, this one, and the one in the tree. Why not? It's your cultural form. So in our culture, we weigh the cost and benefit. We pride ourselves on the rationality. Let's see, am I going to the store now? Well, there's a chance I could get hit by a truck, and then there's lightning, and then I might find my true love in the tomato section. You could do all that, but most of us know, although this is gendered, the women know this better than the men, that there's a little bit of a fakery going on here. That we're nervous about, for example, saying, let's see where life takes me. I mean, some of us manage that, but most of us find that very difficult. So we don't want to go where life in its complexity takes us. We want to have made the proper decision. And we want that because our mother told us when we were little to do it that way. And she was not pleased when we didn't. So we learned that. So one mother teaches you to pray to Saint Sebastian before you eat tomatoes, and another one asks you to weigh the costs and benefits of eating a tomato. Makes you feel better, do it. As long as you don't make claims that you've made the right choice, which by the way is what it's really for, the objective choice, the correct choice. In economics, my colleagues, they said, well, if you don't have a cost-benefit analysis, how do you know whether to invest in there or there? And the answer is, you don't! It's always a struggle. You invest over there. Some people will be happy they want it. Other people will be unhappy they don't want it. It could be a fight. Either you recognize the struggle and take your side, or you pretend that you don't have to, that there's an absolute that doesn't require you to take sides. How convenient. You can be on the side that isn't the side. You don't have to take sides. There's an old American Union song that has the following chorus. Which side are you on, brother? Which side of the capital labor struggle? And there's always a large group of people, particularly those with lots of education, who avoid the difficulty of taking sides by imagining that there is a way to participate that is above the two sides. It's the efficient solution. That's a hustle. You know who wins in the struggle of efficiency? I have been on both sides. I've been called into courtrooms where I testify that A is more efficient than B. On the other side of the table are the lawyers for the other side who are saying, no, 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 our studies indicate that B is more efficient than A. Who wins? The one with the most money can buy the most fancy research firm to produce the glossiest report about the Omar. And the jury goes with whatever is the fancier show. You, by the way, you know why I get hired? Because I do cost-benefit analysis? Hardly. I've published work about the absurdity of efficiency. If anyone ever read what I wrote, it, the last person on earth you'd want. Only because the other lawyers don't know anything about my publishing record, fortunately, that they don't bring it up and say, what the hell, you got a person testifying here who doesn't believe in what he just said, which is absolutely correct. But we don't have to worry, they don't know anything about it, they don't know how to look for articles, it's fine. So I'm in there, and you know why they get me? Not because of me and what I do, and it's certainly not because of my reputation, but because, ready? It's America. Because I went to Harvard and Stanford and Yale, and I have all these pedigree degrees. So they say, you see, they
the professor from the day, he went to the bidet.
It must be right. 3/4 of the time, the jury's full. That must be right. My opponent did a research, but he got a degree from the University of Tennessee. End of conversation. It's over. Tennessee only got 3 points. Harvard, 19 points. It's a football game. Except it's won by the money. By the prestige, who can buy? A Tennessee researcher is cheaper than a Harvard researcher. A lot cheaper. But no illusion here. The thing doesn't get passed because efficiency. It's easy in any case to get people to say the efficiency is whatever you want. 3/4 of the time that I ever did efficiency studies was made crystal clear to me by the person hiring us, a group of us, what the result was that they wanted, which we gave them. Why? Because the only way we'd ever get a contract is if we were understood to be an understanding group of researchers who gave you what you paid for. We would never get another job if we were hired to show that A is more efficient than B and reach the result that the reverse was the case. So when you read about efficiency studies, laugh. The alternative is to cry, because this has got nothing to do with anything other than those with the money win. Okay, so that's why Marx wouldn't have thought about talking about efficiency. He could not have imagined in the 19th century the fetishization of efficiency that exists now. It wouldn't have dawned on him as a philosopher especially. Okay, let's then turn to how Marx analyzes commodities. He says what everybody's fascinated by is why the price of something in the market, why do you get $3 for a shirt rather than $300? Why does an ice cream cost this amount rather than something else? What explains it? So now let me, before I go on, deal with that, because that's not such a simple question. Why would people be so interested in prices? After all, a lot of other things go on in the economy. Production and how it works. How do people get together and make some? Not interested. Very little in economics about that. About the price. Why is the price so interesting? And for this, you have to understand the history of economics a little bit. Before markets, goods were distributed, as I told you. Priests did it. Lords of a manor distributed the output. Elders in the community distributed the output. Suddenly human beings, and I'm going to exaggerate here a little bit to make the point, suddenly human beings were confronted by markets, a new arrangement. See, in the old days, I'm going to imagine I'm Farmer Gray. I grow potatoes. And I know my role in the village. I grow the potatoes. And then at harvest time, I bring the potatoes to the village church. And there, Father McGillicuddy sits down and decides, okay, 10 pounds of potatoes go to the Jones family, and let's see, 16 pounds to the Smith family, and he works out, and in turn, I get some bread from the baker, some shirts from the shirt maker, and we distribute. I understand my role, it's very clear. I'm the potato guy. I make potatoes, I make them the same way each year, I get reasonably good harvest except that the weather's bad, and I feed the villagers, just like they provide bread for me and so forth. Now introduce a market and a sudden mystery enters into life. I make potatoes the way I always did. I produce the same bushel, the same red potatoes. But now something bizarre happens. I don't go to the church and watch as Father McGillicuddy distributes these things. No, I go to an open field on market day, and I set up a little blanket, and there I have my potatoes, and people come up and they say, I'd like some potatoes. And I have to say, well, okay, I want some of your bread. And the guy says, okay, I'll give you one loaf for 10 pounds. And I go, what are you talking about? I've been giving you 10 pounds and getting 4 loaves every year. Yeah, the guy says, but you know, the conditions are a little different now. You get 1 loaf. I say, but you know, I'm not going to have enough bread to eat if I give you all my potatoes. The number of loaves you're going to give me, 1 for every 10 pounds instead of 4. And the guy answers me, trained by Samuelson, that's what the market is today. That's the price. Well, suddenly everybody realized mystery had entered life. Before, everything was understandable. I make potatoes, I distribute them, I get bread. But now there's a new institution that I don't understand that called the market, in which I can work as hard this year as I did last. I can produce the same quantity and the same quality of potatoes, but I'm going to drop dead of hunger because it only gets me one bread for my 10 pounds. Instead, the market controls me. The market will determine my life. So I need to understand what causes prices to be what they are. It is the cry of an entire civilization as it goes from a non-market to a market system to cope with the new mystery. A mystery that wasn't there when there were no prices because there was no exchange. When Father McGillicuddy distributes it, you might not like the way he distributed it, but you understand what's going on. Father McGillicuddy thinks you sinned a lot, you lose. You understand, but a market, who could understand it? So a group of people began to develop in European society, where this thing went furthest, earliest, devoting themselves to answering the mystery, solving the mystery. What the hell causes prices to be what they, why does one day I get a loaf for my 10 pounds of potatoes, and the next year or the next month I get four loaves? What's going on? Okay? Now I want to remind you again, Marx is not interested in this. Marx is not interested in this shift. It's an interesting shift, has effects, of course. Whether you have a market or non-market, but that's not what he's interested in. Remember? He's interested in the production and distribution of surplus. That's a completely different question. So Marx, looking at this bizarre interest in prices, is a philosopher and asks himself, why are people focused on that? And I just gave you the answer. He figured out why this was the issue. And so he began to say, let's see whether there's anything in the answers that people have come up with. In the hundreds of 50 years, or 200 years, or 300 years in Europe, that people have been trying to answer this question, I'm going to go through and see whether there's anything useful for me in my quest to look at surplus. Is there anything useful for me in what they have come up with in the way of answers to explain why prices are what they are? And I don't have a long amount of time here, so I cannot go through all that with you. But again, I remind you that the three-volume work of Marx is called Theories of Surplus Value. A different book from Capital is where Marx makes comments on many of those other writers who try to figure out what causes prices to be what they are. Just so you get some idea of the richness. Some people thought prices were what they were because that's what God wanted to Christian Europe, right? God wanted, lots of theorists, God wants the prices to be that. Then there were theories that says God actually wants a different price. It's sinful people who departed from that. Variation. Then there was for a long time a belief that the prices of things were determined by God, but through nature. And through nature they meant land. That it was the amount of land it took to make something happen that somehow determined its price. The physiocrats, a very famous group of thinkers before the modern age, were interested in that. Nature. Land. But Marx wasn't as taken with their answers, although he was interested, he studied it. Marx got really excited when he turned to the great